accordance to the national and global target on biodiversity framework. The government has allocated more than 500 units of protected area spread throughout the country, with the total coverage area of 22 million hectares terrestrial and 20 million marine protected area. Because of its uniqueness and universal values, 6 protected areas are recognized as World Heritage Sites, 16 Biosphere Reserves, 7 Ramsar Sites, and 7 ASEAN Heritage Sites. Many studies and researches has also been conducted to identify plants and animals to assess their potential uses for medicine, food, energy, and biocontrol for a chemical hazard. Some community-driven activities such as ecotourism has also contributed to the effort to preserve Indonesia's biodiversity, which also encouraged cooperation among local stakeholders. The results are heartening. By 2019, Indonesia has been able to increase the population of endemic and priority species. Communities have also enjoyed benefits from this improved environment through ecotourism, environmental services, and other significant conditions, which contribute to their quality of life as a whole. There is little doubt that Indonesia's vast biodiversity plays a hugely significant role in reducing the impacts of climate change. By preserving its biodiversity and its ecosystems, Indonesia can help support the entire planet's sustainability and ensure a better future for all humankind.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Selamat pagi, Bapak, Ibu, berserta rekan-rekan yang saya hormati. I hope that everyone is doing well today. Welcome to Symposium 1 of Wildlife Ecology, Conservation and Management International Conference, WECMIC. Let me introduce myself. My name is Watasha Kana Azahra, and I will be your MC for today's discussion. First of all, I am very happy to be able to be a part of today's discussion. And the theme of Symposium 1 is Current Status of Wildlife Research and Conservation in the Tropics. We'll be hitting off WECMIC with an abstract presentation session followed by expert talks after the break. For abstract presentation, we'll be joined by 6 presenters. Allow me to introduce our presenters for today. First of all, we have Mr. Jarad Wahyudi from Balai Taman Nasional Gunung Merbabu, then followed by Mr. Abdil Adam Utama from Universitas Gajah Mada, followed by Dana Rizky Prihandi from Universitas Gajah Mada, and Mr. Muhammad Farhan Adin from Universitas Negeri Jakarta, Mr. Ryan Afriandi from BBKSDA Riau, and Mr. Muhammad Khairul Ikhwan from Borneo Nature Foundation. This session will be chaired by the Honorable Dr. Sunarto. First of all, let me introduce Dr. Sunarto to everyone. He is a research associate in the Research Center for Biodiversity, Institute of Sustainable Earth and Resources at the University of Indonesia. He is also a wildlife and landscape ecologist for WWF on 2011 till 2020, and is also a kinship conservation fellow since 2019. He took his PhD in Wildlife Sciences at the Department of Fisheries and Wildlife Sciences at Virginia Tech, USA. And throughout his career, he's been putting out researches, papers, and publications on conservation and wildlife as well. And so before we start our presentation, please allow me to read out the presentation guidelines for this session. Our presentation guidelines includes first, the participants are required to present to be present in the waiting room 15 minutes before their session starts. The participants must activate their camera during the presentation. The presenter's camera must be at eye level, and the presenter should look directly into the camera while speaking. Presentations should be presented in English, and each presenters are responsible for ensuring a smooth network connection. Participants will be given host access to operate their material at the time of their presentation, and the chair of each session will introduce the presenter. For the abstract presentation participants, each abstract presentation participant is allocated 20 minutes, 12 minutes for the presentation, and 8 minutes of Q&A. The participants are limited to 3 questions, which will be selected by the session chair. So maybe without further ado, we'll start the presentation by inviting our chair session for today to Dr. Sunarto. The time is yours.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Mrs. MC. Just want to check, can everyone or can anyone confirm that you can hear me okay? Because I feel like my connection previously was kind of like breaking up, or maybe the other side. I'm not sure. Can anyone say
okay? I can hear you clearly, sir.
Yes. Okay. Yes, you can.
Okay, great. Great. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for everyone who are already here. It's really a great pleasure and privilege for me to be given this opportunity to lead the first session of this WETMIC webinar and conference. I think this is a really a great opportunity that we should make the most, because I think I know that everyone is busy, right? So by spending here, that I hope that we can learn and bring things to home and improve our wildlife management. So today, for the first symposium, we're gonna have 6 presenters from a variety of background. There are people from the government, there are from NGOs, from academic, and also it represents several subject areas in terms of species as well as regional. So there are few from Kalimantan, Sumatra, as well as Java. And interestingly, it's also represent the wildlife in wild habitat as well as in the urban areas. So it should be a quite interesting session that we are looking forward now. So without further ado, I would like to invite our first speaker. I think it's Mr. Jarod, yeah, from Balai Taman Nasional Gunung Merbabu, with the presentation on the distribution of rek-rekan Presbytis comata fredericae in Resort Selo of Gunung Merbabu National Park. Pak Jarod, the floor and the screen is yours. Over to you. Thank you. Enjoy, everyone. Yes.
Okay. Yeah, thank you for Dr. Sunarto, and I will be happy by Dr. Sandy to share my presentation. And first, good morning. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank for all for this opportunity.
Waalaikumsalam.
And yes, in my study, it is about the distribution of rek-rekan Presbytis comata fredericae in Resort Selo, Selo Resort of Gunung Merbabu National Park. Okay, next. Yeah, next, this is my abstract, our abstract, yeah. Yeah, introduction, the Suriri Jawa or Rekrekan for local name. The distribution, we have two site monitoring. That is Block Sikendil and Block Pandean. But the focus in this study is in Block Pandean in Selaw Resort. Yeah, in the map is in the lower, yeah. Okay, next. Next, sir. Yeah. Okay, the background, we study about the rekrekan because the Javan Surili is endemic primate in Java Island. And this is UCN, is threatened and endangered species. For us, for Gunung Merbabu National Park, this species is a species priority for management National Park. And there is a forest fire in the National Park. Almost everywhere, every year, we had a forest fire. But the case of this study, we focus in 2019. Of the effect of the forest fire. Then the distribution of rekrekan, especially in Resort Solo, there is a shift distribution from 2015 to 2020. Our objective for this study is to knowing the distribution of rekrekan during 5 years later, then knowing the cause of the spread of rekrekan in the Selaw Resort area. Yes? Oh, next. This our picture of rekrekan in the center of picture. We have three primates in National Park. And there is a long-tailed macaque and Javan langur. Next. Yeah, material and method. We use the material need to the data collection. We have a survey and monitoring every year. And there is a map of National Park, the GPS, binocular, digital camera, and at all we use ArcGIS 10.6. The method, we to know the distribution of rekrekan, we determine by using the present data of the survey and monitoring in each year in the area of Resort Selaw. We use a haphazard sampling procedure to the location, given location in the area. There is a three location from Selaw Hiking Trail, Simpang Macan Road, and there is a Pitikan block or path. Next. Yeah, this on the map of the route, and to considering the grid of map of National Park, we have collecting the data of fauna and flora in the National Park and focusing to the rekrekan. Next, yeah, the result. The rekrekan encounter in 2013 to 2019 survey. This the table that we have a survey every year, and we collect the distribution of rekrekan by coordinate GPS and the level hike of meter or MDPL in Indonesia. The distribution before forest fire in October 2019, there was the position of rekrekan in altitude 2,200 to 2,700 meter above sea level. There is on grid E15 and I-19, 16, sorry, 15 to 16. Which include the category to upper mountain forest ecosystem. And based on the Zonation National Park 2017, they are the position of rekrekan is located in the core zone, rehabilitation zone, and wild zone. Okay, next. Next slide. Yes. Yeah. This the location rekan-rekan encounter that 5 years in the past we collecting the survey and monitoring. There's in the below on the map, yeah. And next, so on the distribution of rekan. Next, sir. Next slide. Yeah, in the end of year 2020, so there is a shift in encounters which previously were easy to find in the grid of IA15 and IA16. Carry out in July, we had monitoring. There was no rekan in that grid, and they have shift to grid of J16 with altitude only 2015 meter above sea level until 2067. Yeah, this is we new finding from the rekan in the location after the forest fire in October 2017. And almost this the picture of the map, the forest fire. This the accident of forest fire. Left up is the post to Pandean, and this pendakian slow route for hiking, and below is Ngelorok Hill about Tulangan. Okay, next. Yeah, this the shift encounter and distribution of rekan in resort slow. There is RR is area 1 to area 5, yeah, 1 to in the earlier they find in area 1 3, and after the accident of forest fire they move or shift to area 5 and 4. Okay, next. Our conclusion of this study, the rekan encounters in 2015-2020 in the Selo Resort is shift in distribution. In the early year, it's easy to find in area 1 and 2. Then in the middle year, 2017, still in area 1, 2, and the additional area, area 3 in Simpang Macan, there is 6-point encounter of rekan. Then the last year 2019, before forest fire, is found in area 1 and 2 and 3, and then after forest fire incident in October 2019, there is an impact for shift of rekan. We have monitoring in 2020. There is more below the MASL before. They move to area 4 in Dok Malang, Dok Cilik. We find 2 points of encounter, and area 4 in Tulangan and Heng is there is 3 points. Indicating the presence of rekan in location was influenced by the habitat condition that affect of forest fire, and there is adequate habitat availability, and the rekan become essential matter to be considered in our management of national park. This our study conclusion. And next, the documentation of our monitoring survey in 2019 month of June. There's the rekan they eat the acacia dakuran. This trees was flowering. Then next in 2000, yeah, this a group of rekan-rekan as fit kemelandingan gunung Manikura Javanica. Next, in 2018, we found we has monitoring in November. They're still in the same place, area 1, 2, and 3. Next, okay, next turn this 2017. Yeah, we collect the data rekan and the earlier years. Next, we almost find in many area pet or block in the Pandean, Ngelorok. Next, this the landscape of area monitoring. The picture taken from post 3 of Slow Route. That's the center of Tulangan. Yes. Okay, that's my presentation, and thank you for all. And I hope this very quite a presentation. Thank you for all. Okay.
Thank you so much, Pak Jarod.
Okay.
Right on time, or slightly sooner actually. So we have quite plenty of time for questions. Is there anyone has any question for Pak Jarod? I haven't seen anybody typing question, right? Or do I miss anything? Probably the committee can help me if there is anything that I missed from the question and answer. Is there anyone sending any question already? If not, maybe I can start with a few questions from myself to trigger the conversation. Also, we still have I think few minutes for you, because we started a little bit later. And I hope the next presenter is okay with that. So it's very interesting, Pak, on the study with the condition that the habitat has changed with forest fires. Yeah. So I have actually a few questions for myself, but I will say one or two first, so that others, if they have any questions. By the way, you can type your question if you like. You can say it in Bahasa or any language, and I hope that someone can help translate also. So my question, Pak, so what type of strata in the forest that this species mainly use? Maybe you have already said it in your presentation, but I might have missed it. And also, what is the maximum elevation that this species can go in the mountain? Because I saw that the habitat, the landscape that you show on the picture, it looks like there are not so many trees. And I assume that this species actually depend on the availability of trees to move around also, right? Over to you, Pak. I hope my question is clear.
Okay, yeah, it was clear. Thank you for the question. For the first question, and the strata of rekan-rekan is about they are animal arboreal animal, and their strata is about to the maximum about 2 until 3 meter upper of the forest floor. Often they come to the forest floor to take a food. We call petong, this shrub trees, shrub vegetation, and they take the very young leaf, and then they go up again to the trees. Usually they use acacia decurrent trees, this tall about 5 to 10 meter, and to kesawa trees in the middle of our forest. And the maximum for second question, maximum level, they in the early year in 2015, 2017, and 18, They use until 2,500 meter above sea level. This almost post three if we have activity of a slow route track for hiking. And below level is about post Simpang Macan. That is 2,200 meter above level sea level, yeah. And after the incident of forest fire October 2019, they move or shift to more below about Simpang Macan to Tulangan. Simpang Macan is about 2,200 and Tulangan is 2,100. So they shift to the more below of the before incident of forest fire. That's my answer. Maybe there is another.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Pak Jarod. Very interesting. Is there anybody want to say any question? Feel free to raise your hand or type it. If not, I will try to ask my second question. Anybody before I say it? Oh, okay, here there is a question from Festi Atmaja. A question to Papa Jarod. Is there any effort from the management authority at the Taman Nasional Merbabu to revive the fire site? Over to you, Pak.
Okay, thank you for Festi Atmaja. Yes, our effort of the management of National Park, we have every year ecosystem restoration. We planting the food of the rekrekan. There is acacia dekuran dan tangsa, sowo, and at all. Also, we have protecting the area by patrolling our forest ranger, and we use local citizen, local community with masyarakat peduli api. We have a patrolling, and then we are always our monitoring routine and every year, and also we start. Yes, we study with another academic, and there is from UNS, also there's UGM and IPB. And they UNS is specialist to studying about 2 years, and this the end of their years, and that our effort. And usually we have every year program to the our personnel in the field, pengendali ekosistem hutan, PEH, we have monitoring and also prepare our next step for rehabilitation the area. This our efforts. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Pak Jarod. Ms. Festi, I hope that answer your question, yeah? Anybody else? Having any questions? I think we can take one more. If no, maybe I will ask my second question then. Okay. I hope it is okay, Pak, yeah?
Yeah, it's okay.
Okay, because yeah, I want to make this the most of this opportunity, Pak, by having you here. So, yeah. And I have a lot of other questions, but maybe we can discuss it another time. But my second question is, you said that there is an indication of the shift in distribution, right? And do you think how long it will last? Is it like permanent, or is it temporary, or is it already probably even coming back because of the regrowth, for example? Because I believe that it doesn't take that long if the rain is falling after the rain after the fires, right? And the regrowth might come back, and I think the species depend on it. Is that correct, or what is it like, Pak? Over to you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for the question. For the habitat, the rekrekan animal is need food for their life. The main food is Acacia decurrens and Manicura javanica. After forest fire, these two species is fast growing species. So they move is temporarily, maybe need about 3 until 4 years. They will back to the main area, to the area 1, 2, and 3. Because the last we have monitoring of our area in the this year 2021, we found the small group in area 2 about post to Pandian, but find the rekrekan. So this is a temporary shifting of the encounter. This depend on their food in the habitat. So when the Acacia decurrens and Manicura javanica is growing, there is a fruit and leaf. The young leaf, they will be back to that area. That my question. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Pak Jarod. That's very interesting, and I hope that the incidence of forest fire doesn't cause any kind of like bottleneck, causing a lot of the animal to die. Hopefully, and then the animal will be able to recover after the fire.
Yeah.
Thank you. Very interesting study, Pak. Good luck with the next study and field investigation, and also your study academically. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, and thank you for sharing your knowledge today. So I think it's about time to move to the next presenter. Mr. Abdul Adam, are you here? Are you ready?
Oh yes, I'm ready.
Okay, Pak. The time. Let me while you're preparing your presentation to show on the screen, I will introduce Pak Abdul. Adam Utama is from Gajah Mada University, and he's going to present the study on the building size effect on bird community assemblage in tropical urban ecosystem. The screen is yours, Pak. Over. Thank you.
First,
can you make full screen, Pak, so everyone can see it clearly? Thank you.
It's my presentation. First, let me introduce myself. I am Abdul Adam Utama. I'm from Universitas Gajah Mada. Today, I will present my research about building size effect on bird community assembled in tropical urban ecosystem. For the introduction, land use activities carried out by humans have changed the structure of the ecosystem on Earth's surface. The way human use land has a major contribution to the formation of landscape pattern, one of which is urban area. The construction of building in urban area is one of the factors that cause change in the landscape of the urban area. Landscape change that occur can result in the fragmentation of animal habitats that that live in urban area. Good urban area spatial design is expected to improve the environmental quality of urban ecosystem. Characteristic of urban structure such as spatial configuration and distribution of building types are some of the factors that influence the distribution pattern and the abundance of bird species that have habitat in urban areas. This research actually aimed to determine the effect of building type on the diversity of bird species in daerah istimewa Yogyakarta. And then for the method, the data collection is collected in the daerah istimewa Yogyakarta, and the data was recorded from the three level of urbanization, rural, suburban, and urban. The bird data was recorded using point count method, and then the building type data was obtained by subtracting digital surface model data and digital evaluation model in built up area using QGIS software. And then the bird community data was represented using abundance, species richness, and Shannon Winner index. And then for the analysis, we use canonical correspondence analysis. CCA is used to visualize the response of bird to the type of building. And then after that, we use GLM to determine the effect of the type of building on the diversity of bird species. And then for the result, we can see the suburban has the highest abundance, and then the urban has the highest index diversity, Shannon Winner, and then the at the species richness, urban has the lowest point. From the CCA result, we can see that at all the level of urbanization, bird community have a correlation with building cover at height of less than 18 meter, and in rural area, bird community have a correlation with vegetation cover at herb and sub level, and in suburban area, bird community have a correlation with building cover at height less than 18 meter, and the correlation in the suburban area is a negative correlation, where the response of the bird community is inversely proportional to the value of building cover that has height of less than 18 meter. In urban area, bird community have a correlation with vegetation cover at the herb level. In addition to herb, there are one species bird that has a positive correlation with building cover at that have height of 18 to 30 meter. And then we can based on the GLM model, it can be seen that herb cover has a significant influence on the abundance and the speciousness in all urbanization classification. And in rural area, sub cover also has a positive effect on abundance. The existence of sub cover in an area can provide shelter and a place to find food for several bird species. An urban area is an area that has the least shrub cover among all the urbanization level. The addition of shrub cover in urban area can increase the complexity of the existing vegetation cover. The addition of shrub cover is also expected to increase the abundance and speciousness of birds. And then in the suburban area, we can see that building that has height of less than 18 meters, has a negative effect of abundance, speciousness, and diversity index. In addition to the type of building, the heterogeneity of building height has a negative effect on the abundance, and the average building height has a negative effect on speciousness. Building cover in the built-up area can create an unfavorable environment for bird species that require forest research, such as trees and shrub that can be used to nesting site. The presence of building cover can harm birds due to increased predation. This is because the nesting habitat of several bird species can be exposed to predator, especially those that nest above ground or ground nester. And then in the urban area, building type that has a height of 18 to 30 meters has a positive effect on abundance. That building type has a positive influence on abundance. And then a building with a height of 18 and 30 meters tends to function as a substitute of nesting habitat for several species of bird, especially colonial bird species that prefer tall building structure to low structure. This can be seen from the discovery of bird nesting on the roof of the type 18 to 30 meter building in urban area. According to the last research, heterogeneity of building types with a large number of the height of 18 to 30 meter building cover can increase the abundance of bird species. And then for the conclusion from our research is the existence of building resulting from urbanization has a serious impact on biodiversity, one of which is birds. In this study, it was found that shrub cover had a positive impact on bird abundance. Bird cover has a different impact at its level of urbanization. The existence of the type that has height of 18 to 30 meters building has a positive impact, while the lower building has a negative impact, making special plants that provide more variety of plant cover like shrub and tree, and diversity of building types based on the height is expected to increase the bird diversity in urban area. Maybe it's the end of my presentation. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, Pak Abdil, for your presentation. Another very interesting session. I will probably also have a few questions, but I will let the audience to give question first, for sure. I will just say my question if there is extra time. If not, I will prioritize everyone.
Is there dari Indonesia? Tapi ada ini kan skala internasional ini kompresi.
Can someone mute the participant that is not asking question, please? Because it's the voice is here. Do I miss anything? Is there any question from the participant, maybe, or from the YouTube or other channel that I miss here? Because I don't see any. In fact, I saw one more question, but for the previous presenter. Maybe we can come back to that after the session is finished. Or maybe anybody want to ask question directly, you may raise your hand and we will give the mic open for you. If not, maybe it's a privilege for me then to ask question for you, Pak Abdil. Is it okay?
Yes. Okay.
Okay. Yeah, I have a few questions, Pak. So you probably mentioned it in your presentation, but probably I missed it. But Where is the study area actually, Pak? Which cities that were included, and also which type of species and what species on the list of the assemblates that you mentioned? Thank you.
The study area is at province of DIY, Daerah Istimewa Yogyakarta, and the study area is at the rural area, suburban area, and urban area. And the species that we found is in the total is 37 species, and the
Hello,
are you there, Pak?
Can you present the list of species that you recorded?
Who is speaking, by the way?
Sandi.
Oh, Pak Sandi. Oh, okay.
Yeah, the co-author.
Pak Sandi is the co-author. Okay, Pak. Sorry.
Yeah, Abil is my student under my supervision, actually.
I see. Okay, Pak. Thank you. And by the way, there is also another question. Interestingly, same as what I already asked partly. The question is, boleh tahu lokasi pengamatannya di mana dan bolehkah ditampilkan landscape-nya? So if you can show the landscape as well, if there is any map on that, maybe this will help. The question was from Karimatul Fajriya. And there's another question here also. Can I just read the question first, Pak? Maybe you can address it at the same time probably.
Yeah. Abdul, maybe you can show us the map. The sampling for sampling map.
Oh yes, so please wait.
If not, maybe you can just. Tell the area, Pak. Maybe if it takes time, because we only have like 2 minutes, and maybe the participant who has questions can also discuss later with you. I think your contact address is there. If you don't mind, I will read the next question from Fon. Thank you for that presentation. I'm just wondering why the diversity index age of urban site is too high, wherein the richness is too low in value. Maybe you can address that first part while mentioning maybe the actual site of the landscape. Over, thank you.
Yes, for the question from Wisnu Sukmantoro. Is it from Wisnu or?
No, the question I read was from Fon, and previously was from Karimatul Fajriya. And Pak Wisnu, question maybe later. Wisnu has the question from YouTube, I think, that is directed here on the chat. Or Pak Sandi, feel free if you have anything to say while waiting from Pak Abdul.
Okay,
because
so
we only
like,
have 1 minute.
Okay.
Thank you.
I will class. Okay, at first I will answer the location and the location of the research. The location of the research is well, research was conducted in Yogyakarta. Yeah, so in the city center, the urban area is Yogyakarta, Kota Madya, and after that and the suburban is in middle between the rural and city center. Actually, we define and the location by considering the width area. Yeah. So we use the satellite imagery to decide that, and there are four big plot that the size is 4 kilometers square. Yeah. And inside the 4 kilometers square, there are at least 25 plots. So that means we have plot, the number of plot in city center is 100 plots, and suburban is 100 plots, and rural is 500 plots. And thank you for that. And I'm just wondering why the GFC index is 8 of food and chat is 2 and the richness is too low in. So maybe like because the diversity index, the diversity index and diversity index is considering the species richness and also the density of the bird or the number of each species. So maybe in urban area, the species, the number of individuals of each species that found in urban area is high. Yeah. So that's why the value of canon diversity index is also high. Even though the number of species is less than the rural area or the suburban area. And then after that, what's it? Perkumpulan jaring. Okay.
Yeah, maybe you can address the second question, the last question from Pak Wisnu also, Pak. At the same
okay,
time.
Okay, Pak Wisnu. Okay, okay.
Yeah. That one, the first. So you can read the question there, or should I read it?
The positive impact of H2 type building, because mostly of the H2 type building is hotels and campus or university that have really good landscaping. Yeah. So in the surrounding area, they have good the buildings have good landscaping that contain of many ornamental species of plant that can be used and or that have a good use for bird species. Not only provide the nesting for the whole nesting birds, but also for the bird that live in the shrub or also in the grown nester bird. Yeah. That's why it's two species mostly give a positive impact of abundance. And another set also because mostly nearly in the hotels or maybe in the campus, mostly they will produce like food remains from a meeting or also from the restaurant. So the organic matters in surrounding of that building is maybe higher compared to the H and the lower building. Yeah, the lower type, that means like H1, that egg is less than 80 meters. That's maybe that is the easy explanation for that.
Okay, thank you so much, Pak. Pak Sandi, Pak Abdul, maybe you have anything to add before I close this session? If not, maybe I can ask a quick question, Pak. So what is the key message so far from this research so far that the public need to know, like in summary, if possible, like one sentence?
Okay.
If you can see
then that. The one sentence is like, okay. So like, what is it? The human dominated landscape is not like, it is like developing following the time, and it's called what is Anthropocene, yeah? Anthropocene, and create the new biome that's called Anthrom. And then I think it's create the new genuine habitat for all of living organisms. So the way how human design the landscape inside the Anthrom, it will be significantly influenced on the organism that living inside that humans. That's all. So then that means that how to create the good landscape design is not on it, the developer or the landscape planner not only consider the type of building itself, but also how to create the design that also suitable for the other species, maybe like the adding for the variety of by adding the variety of plants, yeah, that is start from tree or shrub and grass, and also how to manage the distribution of each building type, considering the distribution of species.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Pak Sandi and Pak Abdil, for the presentation and for sharing the finding from your research. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, everyone. I think we cover everything, all questions answered by now. So, and we already passed the time, so let's move on to the next presenter. It will be Dana Rizky Prihandini from Universitas Gajah Mada. And the presentation will be on the role of urban green space design to support bird community in the urban ecosystem. So I think this is totally in line with the previous presentation. So hopefully we can also discuss further from here. So Dana, are you there?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. The screen is yours.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Sunarto. Let me share screen my presentation first. Wait a minute.
And while waiting, so if anyone has any further question related to urban bird, I think this can still be discussed here. So just feel free to type your question so we can discuss it later. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Good morning, everyone. My name is Dana Rizky Prihandi. I'm a student from Faculty of Forestry, Universitas Gajah Mada. So right now I will present to you our research about the role of urban green space design to support bird community in the urban ecosystem. Wait. Okay. So for the introduction, urbanization causes an increased number of human population, and it causes the expansion of urban area that makes a serious threat to the biodiversity in it. Forest destruction due to urbanization can threaten the existence what animals with species that are sensitive to their environment and wildlife habitats, along with change the landscape due to urbanization. Open green space is an alternative solution in maintaining biological diversity in urban areas. So open green space is a space in urban areas whose cover is dominated by trees, shrubs, or grasses, either naturally or intentionally planted. In open green space, the existence of open green space can increase the variety of landscape forms in urban area. And then open green space is an important component for biodiversity conservation to conserve wildlife in urban areas. Open green space is also important element of space for a city in a effort to maintain the quality of the city's environment by controlling air air pollution and water infiltration media. So bird can be a good indicator for the environmental quality because bird are type of animal that can move in different habitat types and habitat areas, and is often as used as an indicator of habitat quality in urban areas. It is important to conduct research on bird species diversity in a green open space to find out how great open green space is protected by diversity is in urban area. This research is aim to identify role of various open green space design on bird biodiversity. For the materials and methods, study areas is located in open green space of Daerah Istimewa Yogyakarta. The green open space used as the research location is a green open green space located in urban and suburban areas. Data collection is carried out in the morning at 6 until 7, until 10 a.m. and in the afternoon at 3 until 6 p.m. because it would it indicated as a peak of bird activity. So for determining urban and suburban area, we use a percentage of built-up area using the classification of Maslow with the output in the form of grid of a grid with a size 2 times 2 kilometers square and then we are processing Landsat 8 OLI PIRS image using a quantum chess 3.18, and then we are quantifying the percentage of built up area using the tools in the quantum chess desktop 3.18 software, namely the semi-automatic classification plugin and raster layer unique values report. Then we did after we had a the classification lane. Classification lane image. We determine the point on each green space that is in the grid by looking at the latent classification tool image. Then a bird observation point was determined with a distance as far as 400 meters. So this is the land classification that we are the result from the special data, and the yellow one was a built up area. It was an urban city of Daerah Istimewa Yogyakarta, and the green one for the vegetation. Yeah, and this is a study area which black grid was for open green space in urban level, and the red grid was for open green space in urban suburban level. For vegetation data collection, we use nested sampling to identify shrub and tree species data, and we use protocol sampling to obtain shrub and tree cover. For the bird data collection, we use a point count with distance between the point as far as 400 meters. Consensus site that 400 meter distance will be more effective for data collection of land bird. Besides of that, it will be more effective for data collection in urban area with a wide study area like province Daerah Istimewa Yogyakarta. For the data analysis, we calculate the bird diversity with Shannon-Wiener index, and then the Kruskal-Wallis test to analyze the value of diversity in different types of green open green space. And then we use a generalized linear model to determine the effect of the environmental factors on the diversity of bird species. And then we use canonical correspondent analysis to visualize the bird response towards environmental gradients. This is the result from the 178 observation point that have been observed. We conducted 5 different type of open green space, were including gardens, agricultures, parks, cemeteries, and greenways. For the vegetation structure, uh, for the for the largest open dispense area is by agriculture with a average 2.01 hectares, and then for the smallest open green space area is the park for cemetery for 0.24 hectares. So for the vegetation structure and composition in the five open green space, we found a total 187 species of shrubs, and we found a total of 64 species of tree were found. Tree cover and shrub cover can also show the structure and composition of vegetation in green in open green space. From the five types of open green space, tree cover and shrub cover actually have a similar value. But in this graphic, we can show that the gardens are relatively more high than any others, than any others open green space type. So for the bird species searches and diversity, there's a list of data collection in five types of open green space. We obtain as many as 40 bird species with a total abundance of 5,925 individual birds. The diversity of bird species in five types of open green space can be said be not significantly different by looking at the number, but gardens are a type of open green space that has the highest diversity index value of the other four types. But in four species richness, gardens have a more high species richness too. And for the agriculture, have a most species abundance with 2,169. For the effect of environmental factors on productivity, we use cross-calories test that we have found that the type of open green spaces statically did not differ significantly on the diversity of bird species, but the type of open green space were statistically significant to species richness and bird species abundance. And with using a GLM analysis from 18 environmental variables that have been taken, only the slope and the number of vegetation per minute affect the diversity of bird species. For the canonical correspondent analysis, we can show that the graphic of the response of the bird community to environmental factors are related to environmental aspect. We can show that the species is a little below at a horizontal axis and a little bit left-handed and in vertical axis. The point at the black point in there is a bird species that we found, and mostly they are on the in the square number 3. Well, yeah, and we can show that the number of tree species and the jarak from the water bodies affect correlate positive to bird community. Okay. From the data, it is known that the risk of bird species in open green spaces has a significant difference. Gardens have higher species richness than other types. Compared to other open green spaces, the garden has a relatively high number of tree species and the number of shark species as well as tree cover and subcover. In the research of Mason, we can found that number of species has positive correlation with a high diversity of bird in open green space. Another study in Australia also indicated that high shrub and tree cover had an important influence on bird diversity. So creating gardens for both public and private spaces become alternative solution to enhance bird diversity in urban area. And despite gardens to have higher species richness and diversity, but other types of green open space may have different effect on bird communities, such as an agricultural land. In terms of abundance, agriculture has a much higher abundance than other open green space. Agricultural landscape dominated by crops that are a food sources for grazers and insectivorous birds that feed on seed and insect on agricultural. So there are much of organivores and insectivorous birds that makes increase the abundance. From the regression analysis that has been carried out, it also known that slope variable and the number of vehicles affect the diversity of bird species, but have a negative correlation to the diversity of bird species. The number of vehicles causes noise and pollution, causing a reduction in bird population. To reduce the road noise, we can temporal adjustment of traffic flow and outreach the public on increasing dependence on mass transit can be done. The slope has a negative correlation with the diversity of bird species, where the flatter the slope, the higher the diversity of bird species. This is indicated because the research location is in urban areas with flat slopes. In addition, flat slopes help birds to get food, such as seeds that are on a flat surface like street. From the CCA graphic, the number of tree species distance from water sources and shrub cover were positively correlated with bird communities in open green space. This confirmed the above statement about the number of tree species and high shrub cover forming a good bird community structure. There are several variables such as the number of shrub species, presence of people, presence of predators, slopes, and canopy cover, which have a negative correlation in most bird communities, but positively related with some bird species. Public open green spaces such as park are usually visited by humans with their pets in the form of cats or dogs. So this can be will be harming the some bird species. To reduce this effect, it is necessary to create an area in open green space where humans and their pets do not have access to place by planting a pet in such a way that relatively large area consists of shrubs that are not accessible to humans and their pets, and also with rules of tying up pets like in Parker research. So the conclusion is current have the highest species richness and diversity, but agriculture have the highest abundance. Open green space with a high habitat quality, which is this study were found to consist of many species of shrub and trees, and shrub and tree cover also have influence on bird community. Open green space needs to build with a composition consisting of various types of shrubs and trees, such as the garden in this city. Creating more gardens for both public and private spaces become alternative solution to enhance bird diversity in urban area. So that is this is the end of my presentation. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much for your presentation, Padana. Another interesting subject that followed from the previous presenters, and the conclusion is quite detailed this time. And but I think our time is already almost up for this session. So, but I will let probably one question if there is any from audience. I haven't seen anything on the chat. Sorry, my video was off. Okay, but I hope my voice was clear enough, yeah. Padana, can you confirm?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. Is there any question from the participant of the session? And once again, for anyone just joined, would you mind to rename your name, because everyone, for some reason, like our name as the same, Fahrizal. So if you can rename your name on the Zoom, that will help us understand who are here. If there is no questions, I think we can move on to the next session. I will give like 2 more seconds. Wait, there is a question from Fahrizal here. Oh, wait, who is Fahrizal? is there any presence? What presence? I'm not very clear with this question. Can you guess maybe, Padana?
I don't know what presence that
means. Okay. Well, anyway, yeah, the time is up anyway. So I hope that anyone interested in this research can continue contact the presenter. I think Pak Sandi is also the second author of this work. And yeah, feel free to communicate after this conference. Thank you. And let's move on to the next presenter. Thanks again, Pak Dana. Our next presenter will be, let me check my agenda again. I think it's for Pak Muhammad Farhan Adin. Are you here, Pak Ahmad?
Yes.
Okay.
We're here.
Yeah, okay. Okay. While you're preparing, please prepare your presentation and then upload it on the screen. Okay. While you prepare, I will introduce you that Pak Ahmad is from Universitas Negeri Jakarta and will present his research on the role of Siamang Simpalangus syndactylus rubris 1821 acid dispersal agent in Sumatran lowland tropical forest. So the screen and floor is yours, Pak. Over to you. Thank you.
Okay. Is it present, my presentation?
Yes, very clear already. Go ahead, Pak.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. Before we begin, I would like to thank Mr. Nanto for welcoming me and everyone who attends this symposium. Here I am, Muhammad Farhan Adin, will present our study about the role of Siamang acid dispersal agent in Sumatran lowland forest. Acid dispersal is a mutualistic interaction of plants or any forms with animals or their dispersal agents.
Soalnya saya jangan nganggur di ruangan.
For plants.
Saya jangan temani dokter.
Sorry, Pak. Can you stop for a while? Can someone help to unmute the participant that is not presenting, please? Hello?
Okay.
Wait, there is I still hear noise on the background.
Okay, it's for me. Okay.
Oh, okay. Okay, thank you.
Yes. So the result is the interaction of plants or any form with animals or their dispersal agents. The advantage for plants is that the seeds are dispersed from the parent, while the benefits for animals are that they get great nutrients from the seeds they swallow. For the first primates, especially the helobatids, are considered to be important dispersal agents for tropical plants. Moreover, approximately about 25 to 40% of the frugivore biomass in this ecosystem is primates, while helobatids are frugivores, one of which is Siamang. Bukit Basa Selatan National Park is a protected area in Sumatra and also a habitat for Siamang, one of Siamang population pockets in Wajang Research Station, which is located in lowland of southern Sumatra. However, in research regarding Siamang acid dispersal agent in this location is still limited and needs updating. When viewed as a cycle or loop, Wayne and Smith describe it as follows. Focus on the acid dispersal stage. The following is Chapman and Russell's scheme. In predicting seed deposition patterns, seed survival, and sapling recruitment from trees or plant dispersed by primates. In this context, our study is limited from fruit removal to germination. Based on this background, our study aims to determine the pattern of seed dispersal, composition of dispersed seed, and the seed fate dispersed by Siamang in Wajang Research Station. Data collection was conducted in February to April 2021 in southern area of Wajang Research Station, Bukit Barisan Selatan National Park, Lampung. Research procedures. First, Field orientation was carried out, which aims to identify the condition of the study area. Then behavioral observation of 4 adult individuals consisted of 2 males and 2 females from 2 groups of habituated swimmer, group S and group G. Each group was followed since they woke up to rest in the sleeping 3-4-5 consecutive days for each group and interspersed with 2 days between groups. During the observation, the dispersed seeds were collected and grouped into these categories, synzocori for spot seed and endozocori for fecal seeds, and thus on seed size class. During the observation, some seeds are collected and planted in camp, while others are left embedded in the deposit site and marked with tape. Then canopy closure of the deposit site is measured. All these four seeds is continuously monitored to determine the seed fed once a week. The behavioral data collection method used is continuous focal and ad libitum sampling, which focus on feeding and defecation activities. The data collected is as follows. Well, the social data as we collected is as shown in this slide. We perform statistical analysis using R and MAP was created with QGIS. Results and discussion. First, pattern of CMO seed dispersal. As on records, CMO was dispersed through FSSR in the zookery predominantly, in which all fecal sample contained seeds. The defecation activity and the amount of feces deposited of both groups were relatively same. This means they can be analyzed as single unit. As in the graph below, defecation is most frequent and most feces are deposited in morning and tends to decrease toward noon and so on. Dispersed seeds or feces are more often dispersed during raining than in their sleeping prey, and only one deposit clumping was recorded. However, the higher frequency of some sleeping prey accompanied by the high number of feces or seed deposits, the greater chance of clumping, so that seed shadow were aggregated and thought to be associated with post-dispersal seed predation rates. And average good process time, or the time it takes the seed to pass through CMO intestines, is about 23 hours in the range of 13 to 30 hours. The good process time of 2 groups were relatively the same, which means the condition of the digestive system from both groups were similar. However, there were differences in good process time based on seed size class. This variation can be influenced by factor of resting intensity, diet, and food intake. The process time record for each species physical CMO once per day as it follows. Activity of both groups for each special visit more than one per day as it follows. Based on movement data, or ring data, the harmony for group G is about 25 hectares, of which is 10% covers the burden area, while the harmony for group S is about 23 hectares and 70% covers the burden area. Even so, the daily harmony of both group didn't differ. This indicates that accessibility of the home range in the burn area may have recovered and now not affect CMO ring effectivity. We found that movement during dispersion seed didn't correlate to seed dispersal distance. This is because the CMO movement is not linear, but is very resource oriented, especially for fruit source. Therefore, several times CMO were recorded to have revisited the fruit source, which result in the potential for the farthest dispersal distance being limited in the range of this role. The seed shadow or special dispersion of this seed is shown in the graph below. Cross habitat seed result was also by group S because of most of the area and its range root include burn area, even the seeds afferent from this area, example here, Garcinia parvifolia, tend to be more often dispersed far, more than 100 meters. Same that. There was a significant difference in feeding activity and dietary diversity of both groups. This means they also can be acknowledged as single unit. However, there are variations in the feeding time allocation for each individual of both groups, as shown in the graph. Here, AM for adult male and AF for adult female, which all feed on more fruits, both by leaves and flowers. A total of 22 species fruiting plants were dispersed by CMO. Details for the frequency of the social event for each species by each group as shown in the graph. Based on analysis, there was a relationship between seed size and dispersal frequency, where seeds bigger than 3 mm were more often dispersed, but seeds smaller than 3 mm were more dispersed widely. Here, a comparison of situational capacity. In general, it seems that the percentage of gibbon in Indonesia among faces contains it's above 80%, which is higher than orangutans and monkeys. Interestingly, the species richness of Siamang faces sit content from our finding was greater than the others, even among gibbon itself, including Siamang sit result from previous studies. This thought to be a reflection of dietary diversity, especially for the fruits they consume and the seeds they swallow. And positive cell seed fat. Based on our germination test, only 28% of the total dispersed seeds were able to germinate. Details of the total sample plant, the percentage and germination speed as in table. It seems that these four species didn't germinate at all, which may be due to a limited time of observation so that their actual germination ability was not recorded. We also found that the longer GPT or good passage time, the lower seed germination rate. This can occur because the longer good passage time can remove the mesocarp and damage its embryo. Based on in situ monitoring, only 12% of deposit size remains of the overall record. Loss of deposit size leaving no seeds may occur due to environmental factors, moved by secondary dispersers and are preyed by predators. The dispersed seeds and their fate we found from all remaining deposit size as shown in table. We also found that seed and dispersal design were not product to seed germination. This is presumably the difference in tolerance of each species to seed and mortality factors such as predation do not distance dependent. So the effect is different for dispersed seed in each deposit. In the zoochory, our seed dispersal via faces often leaves fecal matter, which not only attracts predators but also secondary dispersers. Their presence, which we observe, is the dung beetle, can greatly determine the post-dispersal seed fate. In fact, several studies have shown them to provide an advantage in avoiding seed predators. In conclusion, from our observation for 3 months, Siamang dispersed in zoochory dominantly. With a good passage time, a mean of 20 hours, the average of seed dispersal distance was around 200 meters from parents. A total of 22 species were dispersed. The germination test showed that only 28% of total plants successfully germinated. In the end, only 12% of the species sets remain while the germination varies. Further studies are needed to test these findings, find out the spatial temporal effect and factors that affect post dispersal survivability to sapling recruitment comprehensively. Before I close, I would like to thank Ministry the Environment and Forestry and Wildlife Conservation Society Indonesia Program for Research Policy Program. Maybe it's some point from this study for our insight. That's all from my presentation. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Pak Farhan. Yeah. Very, very interesting study indeed. Let's see if there's any question. So, I mean, while waiting for people to type any questions, I think we still have, let me see on the time, well, about 5 minutes to discuss things, I think. Yeah, is there any question from the audience? I don't see any on the chat room. Anyone who would like to have any question, feel free to raise your hand and we will give you the mic open. And in the meantime, probably I will ask questions while waiting. Yeah, this research is very interesting indeed, and it was conducted in area that incidentally quite familiar to me. So very happy to see what happened there. So many good research happening, and particularly for this, I think this is very, very not just important but also high time, yeah, to conduct such a research on the seed dispersal, especially now in the era decades of restoration. Yes. The role of wildlife for the restoration is very important, and indeed you have shown that. I have several questions actually to ask, but maybe one quick question is that you mentioned that this is overall about 22 3 species, yeah, being dispersed by Siamang here. So not only, along, yeah.
Is that correct? Not only trees, but plants
totally. Oh, okay, yeah. 22
plants. There's liana.
So, how long is the study period of this? Is it like, I believe if we study longer, maybe the number of species that are on season will be more and so on. Is that the case?
Yeah. For the observation of behavior, we conduct for 1.5 months, and then 1.5 months for monitor the seed fate.
So it's just less than 2 months, basically, right?
Yes.
Study, yeah? Okay, yeah, that's really amazing. So in less than 2 months, the siamang can disperse that many, and so maybe the next study or maybe someone else already doing it. You know, if you're interested in valuing the siamang in terms of the success rate compared to if we do the planting, maybe someone else already doing it or need to do it. So that's a lot of ideas that need to be explored there. Let me see if there's any questions from here, or is there any questions from YouTube that people can help me, the committee, to confirm? Is there any questions from participant here? You can also say your questions in Bahasa or Boso Jowo or any language that we can translate. I also have Google Translate here, so don't worry about language, just in case there is a problem for you. Okay, if not, then I have more questions, but let's find time to chat next time, Farhan and friends.
Yeah.
Greetings to friends from Wai Changu. Well done.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much again for sharing your information. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So I will now move to the next presenter then. It will be Pak Rian from FFI, but represent the collaboration with BKSDA Riau. Will present the research on mammal diversity in Tasik Belat Wildlife Reserve, Kampar Peninsula. Pak Rian, are you there? Oh, okay.
Yes.
That's great. You're already here. It's like the philosophy of Warung Padang. You're already there, ready. That's great. Okay, Pak Rian, and also I saw the Pak Gunawan also, yeah? This is my old friend from Riau. So I'm really happy to see you all, and the time and floors are yours now. Over.
Okay, thank you. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, allow me to thank you for the time given to us in the Wildlife Ecology, Conservation and Management International Conference. I'm Rian from FFI, but I'm here on behalf of Balai Besar KSDA Riau. On this occasion, I will present our collaborative work in Tasik Belat Wildlife Reserve. Our presentation is about overall goal is to conduct initial baseline of biodiversity in Tasik Belat Wildlife Reserve. So initially, this survey will be conducted in two phases. The first phase is in this presentation to conduct biodiversity survey and targeting medium size mammal with camel trap. The next phase will be conduct for other taxon group, such as primate and smaller mammals, also any other species with a suitable method. So this will be limited to the medium-sized mammal with camera trap. Next, the study area was conducted in Tasik Belat Wildlife Reserve. This is the map of Tasik Belat. As you can see, the conservation area is contained with the peatland forest with high biodiversity potential. This area span over 2,529 hectare and located between Teluk Lanus and Desa Penyengat. So it's almost 10 times the size of UGM, yeah. And moreover, the area is very remote. So currently, if we want to get there, it's only accessible via motorboat by the Apit River, almost 8 and 10 hours, depend on the weather from the nearest village. So this is very remote area. and this location also surrounded by the private concession. For data collection, we run a systematic camera trap placement in 20 grid, and each grid was size of 1 km². So if you goes back to the previous slide, you can see there are the grid survey. We almost cover entire area. And because we want to focus on medium size mammal, in each camera trap, we install, we set a 30 until 40 centimeter from the ground, so it will be optimized for medium size mammal. We also install a camera trap from October until January 2029, and we able to get almost 60 and 44 trap days. As the result, we get 22 mammal species belong to 6 order and 13 family, just like the table that we saw to you. And between those mammal species, we also found red squirrel and tree shrew. This doesn't belong to medium size mammal, so this is just like the bycatch product from the camera trap. We also found 2 monkeys, banded langur and silvery lutung. This is also actually, these 2 species is have more arboreal lifestyle, so it's also just like accidentally caught by the camera trap, and we don't know why they come to the ground at that time, so it accidentally captured within our survey. And we also found 2 critically endangered species, Sumatran tiger and Sunda pangolin, and also 10 vulnerable species that highlight in blue on the table. Next, from the slide, we saw there are 2 charts. On the left chart, it is shown the relative abundance index of each species we found on the study. So the relative abundance index mean is a value of independent species divided by 100 trap days. So we use this index, so it can be comparable to other site with even the other site we have a spatial and temporal, different temporal and spatial scale, but it still can comparable. And the right chart, it is shown the proportion of area occupied. Actually, it is generated by the occupancy modeling with constant detection and set variation. So for the simplification of interpretation, we can just say that proportion of area occupied means if the number, just for example, in the birded peak, it is shown that have a value of 0.75. That means this birded peak can be occupied this area as far as 75% for the survey landscape, so it will be easier to interpret. So this indicated the higher the proportion of area occupied mean the species is occupied wider area within survey landscape, and the higher relative abundance index mean this species have more abundance than other species. For the next slide, we will only highlight the 3 group mammal species. For the first group, for the carnivore, we found elephant carnivore species that is suggesting this area have a rich carnivore assemblage here. And the most abundant carnivore in this area is yellow-throat martens on the left picture. It have a relative abundant index as 4.43 and occupied 30% of the area, followed by the banded civet and malay civet. And interestingly, this marten always found and observed moving in a group of 2 or 3. So because of they tend to live in a group, I think that's why the species is more abundant and able to compete with other carnivore species, especially with different species which has similar niche, because the other preferred species tend to live solitary. The next group, from the wildcat species, we only found 3 wildcat species, tiger, marble cat, and clouded leopard. 2 other species that might be inhabit this area, which is flat-headed cat, which specialized in a wetland area, and Bengal cat, which more generalized and occupied diverse habitat, are not found yet. We don't know why. But for the tiger species, as apex predator, we able to identify potentially 3 individual, because we only set the camera on one side of the body, so that's why we say that potentially. But we found in 2 station with only 0.12 abundant index, And we also have a fawn clouded leopard, also for two different sites. So, even though the apex predator is found in a lower abundant index, but from their prey species, from the ungulate, especially for banded pig and moss deer, we found that those two species is have a really high relative abundant index, 4.5 for banded pig and 2.6 for moss deer. And both of these species occupied more than 50% of the area, so indicating they are broadly distributed across habitat survey. And because both of these species also potentially become the prey of the tiger, I think even though the Tasik Belat have a small area, only 25 kilometer square, compared to average size of tiger home range, which is 50 kilometer square, so ideally, tiger Tasik Belat doesn't form the size only that Tasik Belat cannot adequately have a potential habitat for tiger, but from the prey species, they are supporting the survivability of the species. But since the area is surrounded by private concession around the area, we think or we suggest building synergy with them is one of the viable options to ensure the survivability of these wildcat species, even as the protection of the area or become the, what is it there? The expanded home range of the tiger in Tasik Belat in those private concessions. That's it. From the baseline data, we found two apex predator, including high number of carnivore assemblage. And we also found the prey of the tiger, which is banded pig and moss deer, and occupied more than 50% of the area. And those species can be provide the survivability of this wildcat population, but we suggest to initiate multi-stakeholder synergy in supporting conservation area to ensure the survivability of the Tasik Belat. And the last, we'd like to thank you to Pak Heru and Pak Zanir because of their leadership, we are able to conduct the study. And also for all the field team, Mas Ahmad and rest of the team, because of their hard work and dedication, the survey can be done just as we planned. Thank you, Mas Nato.
Thank you so much, Mas Rian. Very happy to see you again, and very nice presentation also. Very interesting study in a peatland area that has been receiving a lot of attention at the moment, with especially with climate issues. And in terms of biodiversity, there's not still very limited research. So this research will contribute quite significantly. I hope it can be continued also. I will check if there is any questions. And meanwhile, if anyone would like to ask the presenter at the moment, feel free to raise your hand. And I will check on the chat if there is any. Okay, so there are a few questions on the chat. First is from Bayu Vita. This is BBRSETP. I assume this is the institution. So the question is, are there any changes in the behavior of the observed species based on the research result to adapt to changes in the habitat condition of this species? Mas Rian, over to you.
Okay, yeah, for Bayu Vita, because this is the initial baseline and we only the first time, so we didn't detect the changes of the behavior, yeah. This is the first time only.
Okay.
And for Pak Yonatan.
There's a second question from Pak Yonatan. You can read it, yeah, but let me read it also just in case for the attendants in YouTube that cannot see this. Yeah, from Pak Yonatan, thanks for the great presentation. Is there any plan in the future to expand the research or prioritize focus to some species?
Yeah, sure. So the second phase of the biodiversity survey will be focused on smaller mammals like bats and rats, also for primate in arboreal, as well for other taxon like reptile, bird, and freshwater species, because in the peatland forest, the freshwater species is need more attention, I think.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mas Rian. One more from Mas Fido Albert, the question is, as your camera quite low from the ground, how is the result of pictures, videos on the big mammals such as tiger, sun bear, etc.? Did you recommend the way to see or to set cameras to others?
Okay, for question number one, just like the slide before, you can see the within that height is a quite adequate for a tiger and sun bear because it's exactly the full flank of the body is shown in the camera trap. And for the other species, like if you want to specialize the study for the smaller wildcat species, you can set it at the lower height for camera from the camera trap. Yeah.
Thank you. I hope that addressed your questions, Pak Wido Albert. Is there any questions from anyone? Anyone also feel free, we still have maybe 1 minute for one more questions. If not, actually I'm curious, Pak, for a long time about this place, yeah, like Tasik Belat, and there's all another reserve called Tasik, what is it, Tasik Sebelat or something, not far from there. Yeah. And it looks very, very small as a wildlife reserve, and I still didn't understand how it was set up and what was the reason why it was only that small. Do you have any historical background on that, the information?
Well, for the historical background of the management, I think the one who suitable to answer might be Mas Gunawan, if you want to add it. Mas Gunawan?
Yes. Excuse me, Mas Narto, how are you?
Yeah. Hello, Mas Gunawan. I'm good, thank you. Good to see you again. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, can you help? I was asking the question that the reserve looked very small as a wildlife reserve. Yeah. I don't know what was the history of the establishment.
Yeah.
Of
so, Tasik Bulat Wildlife established in
2000. Sorry, Mas Gun, your voice is kind of like fading. Or is it my connection? Mas Rian, can you hear me okay? Or?
Yeah, I can hear you, Mas.
Oh, okay, so maybe Mas Gunawan has a bad connection now. Anyway, maybe while waiting, you can. Oh, okay, yeah, Mas Gunawan. Can you hear me? Oh, it's okay, Mas Gunawan. Seems that your connection is not favorable at the moment. So maybe you can chat another time.
Hello?
Yeah, okay. Now it's better.
Okay. Sounds okay, like... sorry.
Okay. But your name now become Farizal, though.
I know.
You can change it later, though.
Okay. Okay. I will change
before. Yeah, it's okay.
Okay. Tasik Belat was established in 1999, okay. Which is have a purpose in management to protect Sumatran tiger. So Tasik Belat Wildlife Reserve and then Tasik Serkap and then Tasik Besar Serkap is pre-conservation area. Which is in one landscape we call Kampar Semenanjung Kampar. Okay. Kampar Peninsula, I'm sorry. So that place, that landscape is one of habitat of Sumatran tiger. Maybe that's one reason why that tree conservation area is established in 1999, which is besides of that, in around that conservation area, there are production forests, which is proposed to restore it. There are restoration ecosystem Riau. So that restoration ecosystem Riau is used for the corridor. Of Sumatran tiger and any wildlife to use this wildlife reserve as a habitat. I'm sorry, Mas Narto, mungkin maybe why English is not well as
No, that's very clear to me. Mas Gunawan, don't worry. It's good. Thank you. Thank you so much. And yeah, maybe we can chat next time also. And by the way, I'm so glad that the research is active now on the ground in there. And we would like to chat more to find out and discuss further, maybe another time. Thank you, and say hi to my colleague and friends in BKSDA and FFI and others there.
Thank you. You're welcome.
Okay, thank you, Mas Rian. So I think this session is finished, and we're going to the next and last presenter for this session. It will be Mr. Khairul Ikhwan from Borneo Nature Foundation, and the presentation will be on revealing the latest felid existence in Barito Ulu, Central Kalimantan Province. This is another very interesting area that I really would like to hear more. And welcome, Mr. Khairul. Are you there? Okay. So the screen and time is yours. Over to
my voice clear enough or not, Pak Narto?
Yes, very clear. Okay. And very interesting, by the way, you can show it this way. I mean, this is nice.
Thank you for the introduction.
Nice, thank you.
Thank you for the introduction. And hello, everyone. You can call me Irul. I am a staff of Borneo Nature Foundation, well known as BNF or BNF. And today I would like to present our teamwork result in Murung Raya District, Central Kalimantan, regarding the existence of felids, well known as wildcats. Yeah. This presentation was also made by Susan Chain, Mahmudi, and also our field team, Adul. Okay. Well, as you can see in our presentation, Borneo Island has an enormous number of biodiversity. Otherwise, there are a few species that are well known. We talk about maybe if wildlife in Kalimantan, people usually say orangutan, but what happened to the others? Then in this study, we try to understand the existence of other species in terrestrial. We believe that small cats are important as their role as a predator in the wild. And we attempted this study in Murung Raya District. As you can see, the yellow color is Murung Raya District, where some areas are part of heart of Borneo or HOB, HOB. And hopefully this data could add more information of HOB biodiversity data. Actually, this is a preliminary study for felids in Barito Ulu. Okay, our study area was on Daya Mumbindo Karunia Company, well known as PTDBK, which is a mining company. Luckily, they permit BNF approximately 1 year for conservation activities. Then we choose and try to understand the existence of felids in this area. For this presentation, I mean, we only use data from May to the first week of September 2021. Every single camera is represented by one grid, which has 25 hectare area. Then we place the camera in the railway, such as an ex-logging trail or ex-community trail, to presume that it's the same as the wildlife railway. Because the target are small cats, we place the camera at 20 to 30 centimeter high, less than Mas Rian, yeah, with 3 to 5 meters length from the trail of the focus point.
Sorry, can I ask a question? What river is that?
Yeah, Barito River. Yeah. Near
and the River. And the tributary to the right is that Murung River or different?
Sorry.
And the tributaries, the small tributaries, is that the Murung River or different river?
The same river, Barito River.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. As usual, every single camera trap was set up for 24 hours with no bait and on picture mode. We use 3 pictures for every trigger, which has 5 second interval. For the next trigger, and to avoid the pseudo absent picture, we use assumption that every 30 minutes for the same species at the same station only produce one single independent event. And I almost forgot, we use three different types of camera, but they are all Bushnell or Bushnell brand. Okay. For the data management and analyze, when the data were collected, all files must be copied to hard drive or flash drive to avoid missing data. Then at the office, we start to rename by using Exifool in RStudio. After that, we categorize every station with every single species on the folder. For the reference to identify species, we use book mammals of Borneo by UNID Pain, and some bird species, we use birds of Borneo by Susan Myers. So this is the important things. While we did the data categorize, we need to type every single species as same as the other same species. I mean, if we found a clouded leopard, for example, we can type a clouded leopard without any capital. It's okay, but if you found again a clouded leopard, you must type a clouded leopard as same as before. And for the next step, we use ChemTrap R to package in RStudio to do the rest thing until we get relative abundance index. Okay. As you can see, the figure is described camera trap deployment records of 20 camera traps units were placed in two steps. At first, we set up 10, then the next 2 months, we add more 10 units. And by this table, we would like to present that even we placed it from May through September, but not all camera was in good condition along with the deployment. It can help us to describe the trap night to get the relative abandon index number for every species in every station in detail. So as you can see, the purple color is active camera, and the yellow one is inactive camera. Okay, here's the valleys in Barito Ulu in Murung Raya district. Until now, we only have found 4 species of 5 species wildcats in Borneo. We are going to tell you the first from the most abundant, a marble cat. We found this species existed on 3 camera trap station with 3 independent event pictures for each station. And this species is nitrated, and the last assessment was 2015. Yeah? Okay, the next species is clouded leopard, which has status list concern from IUCN, and this species only found at 1 station with only 1 independent event pictures.
Sorry, you said clouded leopard, but here leopard cat.
Ah, yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. Leopard cat. Thank you, Panarto.
Okay.
I need, yeah. Anyway, the next 2 species have also 1 independent picture and only in 1 station. We would like to show you a clouded leopard. This species is recently our priority to get more data for understanding its population, yeah, because we could recognize the individual by its pattern. Yeah. For we would like to understand also their habitats and their threats. And for this study, we only have 1 independent captures. Hopefully, by time goes, it will get more data from this area. Okay, we never expected to get this species, by the way, because our senior team member said that along the BNF working area, he only found this species once for entire his work life. This is Katapulma badia, well known as a bay cat, same as clouded leopard. This species is endangered by IUCN. Okay, well, this figure described relative abundant index of felids in our study area. As you can see on the figure, a marble cat has the highest index of relative abundance, followed by leopard cat, clouded leopard, then a bay cat. The differences between the index are because of the variation of trap night on every capture station. I mean, for example, even those 3 species have the same number of independent events, but they are different between their trap nights, and until now we didn't find any yet special overlapping for each species, because if you remember our presentation before, on every species has their own place which were found. So the most question is what next after this. So we propose at least 5 activities or action in the future. First, because we've got a lot of data, I mean, other species, we believe this presentation could be replicated for other species such as Manchek, Great Argus, or other species groups. Then if we have more data, we can visualize their activity pattern. Unfortunately, for this study, we cannot visualize their activity pattern because the lack of data. Third, while we have a lot of data on felids, yeah, for example, and can recognize their individuals, we may understand their density population. And next, we can learn which suitable habitat for each species by occupancy modeling, such as in Sumatra. We hope by this data from Murung Raya District and from Rungan Landscape and from Taman Nasional Bangau Landscape, we can add more data to present and visualize the occupancy modeling for each species in the future. Then last, we can use spatial distribution modeling to predict what happened in the future throughout any predictor, whether this population or each population for this species decrease or maybe the opposite. Okay, this is last our slide. Thank you for your attention, by the way, and we would like to thank to Dinas Lingkungan Hidup Provinsi Kalimantan Tengah, Dinas Lingkungan Hidup Murung Raya, KPHP Murung Raya Unit 1, PT DBK for the permit, and the Cool Guys Program Barito Ulu Field Team. And thank you for the opportunity, Pak Narto, and for your helping. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Mas Khairul. What a nice presentation. Very clear and very interesting work in the heart of Borneo. The picture shows really it's in the position is like exactly like in the middle of Borneo. Very interesting. Let me check if there's any questions from the audience. Oh, or anyone here that are interested in asking any questions, feel free to raise your hand. I think there are several also in the chat. I will read it. But before that, can I just ask a quick question, Pak? There used to be like a Barito Ulu research station, right? I think it's not far from the study area you have, or is it close? I mean, like
used to.
From that place?
This is the Rungan. Sorry, recruit camp, but used to a camp. See, while this study attempt, there are no camp anymore because the camp is broken. Yeah.
So this was exactly in the same area, yeah, of that field station, the study area.
Because the camp was managed by, I don't know.
I think it's forestry research. Research and development in the forestry, right?
It used to, but the area was belonging now in for DBK company. Okay.
Yeah. So anyway, it's the same area, yeah.
Yep.
Oh, okay. Interesting. Thank you. Thank you so much. Okay. Let me get the question from the audience in the chat. From Pak Aprianto, do you follow some guide how to place camera trap in your study area?
So for placing the camera trap, we follow and replicate what Susan Chin and our BNF team did before in Sebangau National Park and Rungan Landscape. So we try to use replicate in Barito Ulu as a preliminary study. Is it works or not? Maybe in the future we can expand the area. Maybe so we follow the methods how to place the camera traps from our colleague in BNF actually.
Okay. Thank you. I hope that answer your question, Pak Aprianto. Okay. So let's move on to the next question from Dia. Thank you for your presentation, Mr. Ikhwan. Seems like the location of your study has relatively high disturbance regarding the human activities in mining or pertambangan. And it is finally known that the location are also functioning as the habitat for the felid species. As far as you know, is there any kind of specific management policy from the PT related to the protection of this species?
Right, this is an interesting question. Thank you, Mbak Fitri, Dia. I mean, Barito Ulu or our study area is a complex, area. This is belonging PT DBK, but luckily we have permit to do conservation action or activities. Yeah. As far as I know, from PT DBK, a mining company, there is no such a thing like your answer, your question. But we hope maybe we can collaborate with the company, because I don't know, is it clear enough or not, same as a palm oil company or not. We hope they have a duty to provide the area, the green area maybe, and then we can do more research in the area for more data, to get at more data biodiversity for HOB. But unfortunately, until now, as far as I know, yeah, there is no such thing like this, from TPT, PT DBK.
Okay, thank you. That will be another subject that we can discuss also, very interesting and timely also. Another question from Rian. Since you use different type or brand of cameras in your study, did you find which one is the best one? And do you think it has any impact of using different of type camera on your study, such as detectability, etc.?
Oh yeah. Thank you, Rian, for the question. We use three type of different camera traps. So which one the best one? Yeah. I think the best one is the cheapest one. but the cheapest one is good, really good. Busnel HD was really good. But the problem when we set in picture mode, the Busnel HD that we use are not, on no glow, not no glow, has no fast trigger, has no fast trigger. So sometimes we get blurry pictures with white screen, but for the best capture, I suggest you the last type of Busnel. I don't know, with Busnel HD no glow with blah 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 series. It has a fast trigger, so there's no blurry blurry picture. Even the species move so fast.
Okay, thank you, Mas Cairo. I think that's hopefully that address your question, Mas Rian. If not, maybe you can discuss further also with anyone who are interested in that matter. Okay, there's a response here from Dia. Yes, I agree with you, Mr. Ikhwan. Hopefully this preliminary study can also provide some insight for the PT to be more concerning of their areas regarding the potential of felid species. Thank you for your answer. Thank you, Dia. I think the time is up now, unless there is any burning question. One more, I'll give like one or 2 seconds, if there is any. Once again, thank you so much, Mas Cairo.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Bernardo.
There is no more question for now. Let's stay in touch in another platform next time to have a discussion and so on. And say hi to our colleague also, Susan and others in Borneo Nature Foundation. Thank you and great work, everyone. And I think this is the end of this session. We have everyone presented, right? Let me check again, just in case I miss anything. Yeah, right. I think we have everyone presented. So thank you so much, all presenters and all attendants, participants, and especially those who have given any questions. Hopefully that will be useful for all of us. And thank you. And I will give the time and screen back to MC, I think. Thank you so much. Have a good day, everyone. Over to you, MC.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Sunarto. And I would like to thank all the participants as well as our viewers who stayed with us throughout the session. We'll have a break before we continue on with our next session, and we'll resume at 2 p.m. with expert talks. And that is all for our session. I would like to apologize if there's any mistakes or any inconveniences. Mohon maaf apabila terdapat salah kata maupun perlakuan. Mohon undur diri. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. We'll see you after the break.
Sejarah Fakultas Kehutanan. UGM resmi didirikan pada tanggal 19 Desember 1949 dan merupakan universitas yang bersifat nasional. Selain itu, UGM juga berperan sebagai pengemban Pancasila dan sebagai universitas pembina di Indonesia. Pada saat didirikan, UGM hanya memiliki 6 fakultas dan salah satu di antaranya adalah Fakultas Pertanian. Dalam perkembangan selanjutnya, melalui Surat Keputusan Menteri Perguruan Tinggi dan Ilmu Pengetahuan Nomor 99 tahun 1963, Fakultas Pertanian dan Kehutanan UGM terpisah menjadi 3 fakultas, yaitu Fakultas Pertanian, Fakultas Teknologi Pertanian, dan Fakultas Kehutanan. Dengan demikian, Fakultas Kehutanan UGM secara resmi dinyatakan berdiri pada tanggal 17 Agustus 1963. Dekan pertama Fakultas Kehutanan UGM adalah Profesor Insinyur Sudarwono Hadjo Sudiro. Berdasarkan SK Direktur Jenderal Pendidikan Tinggi, SK Dirjen Dikti Nomor 163 tahun 2007 tentang pengaturan program studi dan surat keputusan Rektor Nomor 89 tahun 2010 tanggal 1 Februari 2010 mensahkan perubahan keempat program studi di Fakultas Kehutanan menjadi satu dengan nama program Studi Kehutanan. Program studi kehutanan terdiri dari 4 bagian, yaitu 1. Departemen Manajemen Hutan, 2. Departemen Silvikultur, 3. Departemen Teknologi Hasil Hutan, dan 4. Departemen Konservasi Sumber Daya Hutan. Di Fakultas Kehutanan terdapat Dewan Perwakilan Mahasiswa atau DPM yang berperan sebagai Badan Legislatif Mahasiswa dan Lembaga Eksekutif Mahasiswa atau LEM. Kemudian terdapat 4 himpunan mahasiswa minat, di antaranya yaitu Keluarga Mahasiswa Manajemen Hutan atau KMMH, Himpunan Mahasiswa Budidaya atau HIMABA, Family of Forest Product Technology atau Forestech, dan Family of Forest Conservation atau Forestation. Di samping itu, terdapat Badan Semi Otonom atau BSO yang meliputi Organisasi Pencinta Alam atau Mapala Silva Gama, Komunitas Seni Kehutanan atau KSK, Keluarga Mahasiswa Islam Kehutanan atau KMIK, dan Forestry Study Club atau FSC. Sedangkan International Forestry Student Association atau IFSA dan Keluarga Mahasiswa Kristen Kehutanan atau BONITA termasuk ke dalam non-BSO.
Indonesia is one of the largest archipelagic countries in the world, with more than 17,000 islands that spread over an area of more than 2 million kilometer squares. Indonesia is host to several unique ecosystems, containing a large number of diverse species. At least 10% of the world's flowering species, which counts to over 25,000 species, flourish in Indonesia. There are also 12% of the world's mammals, 16% of reptiles, 17% of birds, 6% of amphibians, and over 45% of fishes, all of which are parts of the nation/biodiversity. In order to preserve its biodiversity, which also contributes hugely to the world, Indonesia has taken significant steps in accordance to the national and global target on biodiversity framework. The government has allocated more than 500 units of protected area spread throughout the country, with the total coverage area of 22 million hectares terrestrial and 20 million marine protected area. Because of its uniqueness and universal values, 6 protected areas are recognized as World Heritage Sites, 16 Biosphere Reserves, 7 Ramsar Sites, and 7 ASEAN Heritage Sites. Many studies and researches has also been conducted to identify plants and animals to assess their potential uses for medicine, food, energy, and biocontrol for chemical hazard. Some community-driven activities such as ecotourism has also contributed to the effort to preserve Indonesia's biodiversity, which also encouraged cooperation among local stakeholders. The results are heartening. By 2019, Indonesia has been able to increase the population of endemic and priority species. Communities have also enjoyed benefits from this improved environment through ecotourism, environmental services, and other significant conditions, which contribute to their quality of life as a whole. There is little doubt that Indonesia's vast biodiversity plays a hugely significant role in reducing the impacts of climate change. By preserving its biodiversity and its ecosystems, Indonesia can help support the entire planet's sustainability and ensure a better future for all humankind.